एंड वाइब्रेंट की स्पीकर डॉक्टर उदय थानेवाला. डॉक्टर थानेवाला विल प्रेजेंट हिज स्पीच ऑन पीसीओडी एंड स्ट्रेस. वी हैव ए इंटरेस्टिंग एंड इंफॉर्मेटिव पैनल डिस्कशन ऑल्सो ऑन अपडेट ऑफ जीडीएम मैनेजमेंट. आवर पैनलिस्ट आर डॉक्टर निर्मला सिंह, डॉक्टर साक्षी सिंह, डॉक्टर मीनाक्षी. द मॉडरेटर इज डॉक्टर उदय थानेवाला. I request my president, Dr. Maya Verma, as a chairperson, and I hand over the session to her. Please, Dr. Maya Verma.
Madam. Maya Verma, am I audible?
Yeah, am you I... are audible. You are audible, ma'am.
Okay. I just welcome all of you, Dr. Thanewala, all our panelists and all the audience who are attending this webinar. This webinar is a very, what to say, is a very burning topic, and the topic which has included, which influences the life from adolescence to the late childbearing age group, as well as the all reproductive period of a pregnant lady. That is the burning topic of PCOD and its and the gestational diabetes mellitus. Both of them are having increasing incidence day by day. The reasoning, what is behind it and what influences that causes, which is responsible for the increase in the incidence in these two conditions, will be elaborated individually. The first speaker, Dr. Uday Thanawala, will explain what are the stress of PCOD, how it is influencing our society, awesome. The younger generation, and the parents also.
Yeah.
This PCOD is... Am I not audible again?
No, you're audible, ma'am.
I'm audible.
Yes.
PCOD is influencing so much stress on parents as well as the younger adolescent girl. It has not less embarrassing to the elderly woman who is in childbearing age group, in late, having no issue, having so many regular irregularity, and so on. Then Dr. Uday Thanawala will explain each. Thanawala, I'm introducing him. He is the eminent young, I should say, young obstetrician and gynecologist of Mumbai. He is the elect chairman of ICOG. He is the treasurer of PCOS committee, our national committee. And he is also a past president, vice president of FOCSI also. So I invite Dr. Sonawala, please deliver your lecture and enlighten us and make the people aware of this disease which do not kill, but make the life mess right from adolescence to the elderly age group. Welcome, Dr. Thanawala.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much to have me today in Ranchi. And it is such a pleasure to be here. I think years back, I had done a labor workshop there, I think with Dr. Suman Sinha and other people over there. So greetings from Navi Mumbai, and very nice to be in Ranchi back again. And Dr. Manki, I had met, I think last year in Jamshedpur, and we had a very good session when she also spoke on a similar topic. So I thought everybody speaks on PCO, and yesterday I also took a lecture on the PCOS phenotype and what is new in the management and all, but I think very less emphasis is given on stress. So I thought it's a good, when you're talking about GDM in particular, maybe it's a good idea to talk a little bit about PCO. And then these PCO girls are at a higher risk of GDM. So how to deal with them when they actually conceive, and how to go about that. So I thought it'll make a good, interesting meeting. So with that, I will just go on to the first part of thing. It's a lecture which I had thought what I do in my practice, I will tell you. And I was sort of jolted into thinking about this particular topic when one of my patients about 4 or 5 years back, I just came to know, a 26-year-old infertile PCO girl, infertile girl was coming for treatment, she committed suicide. And we as gynecologists hardly ever even realize when these young patients come to us with a problem of either PCO or infertility, how stressed they are. I had no clue. I had no clue this woman is stressed because she used to come with her husband and the mother-in-law, and invariably the mother-in-law and the husband would speak and she would sit quiet. And I think it's a quite common scenario in all our OPDs. That is what happens. And we don't really inquire what is happening what about their stress levels. So that started, this incident made me think that how can a gynecologist sitting in his busy OPD, seeing patients day in, day out, infertile patients, how much or what can we do to at least elicit or come to know a little bit about the stress which a patient is undergoing? So with that in mind, this lecture was made on, and I did a little bit of work on this. I'll share with you when you talk only of a PCO girl, even if it's a young adolescent girl, there are a lot of causes for the stress, because a young adolescent girl is very, very worried when she's got acne or she's got hirsutism. And of course, infertility and increased BMI, if they're obese, you know, it's linked to mood and distress, and, you know, they're always very stressed about the things. So basically, this is a chronic process. You know, you are telling this woman, okay, now you lose weight. This girl tries, cannot lose weight, it becomes frustrating, or she loses weight for 6 months, then it puts on back again because lifestyle is like this. Time nahi hai exercise karne ka. So it's a very frustrating disorder, PCO. So, you know, keep up with it, they have to really work hard, and that is what we have to counsel them for. So all this thing causes a lot of stress. A meta-analysis of 10 studies reported increased depressive symptom scores in 44% of the patients who had PCO versus 17% in control. So our PCO patients are definitely more depressed and more stressed out. 4 studies reported a 7-fold increase in abnormal anxiety score. It is important to recognize that these patients are stressed. A large international survey has shown that most women report psychological issues are under-recognized, and less than 5% are satisfied with the emotional support and counseling which they get. So I think it's high time the gynecologists take this matter up and start looking at stress and counseling them on how to deal with stress. So even the international evidence guidelines of ASH, which were published in ASHRAE, the PCOS ovarian syndrome in 2018, say that health professionals should be aware that in PCOS, there is a high prevalence of moderate to severe anxiety and depressive symptoms in adults, and a likely increased prevalence in adolescents. Anxiety and depressive symptoms should be routinely screened for in all adolescent and women with PCOS as diagnosis. If screening for these symptoms and for other aspects of emotional well-being is positive, further assessment and or referral for assessment and treatment should be completed by suitably qualified health professionals informed by the regional guidelines. If treatment is warranted, psychological therapy and pharmacological treatment should be offered in PCOS, and an optimal interval of anxiety and depressive symptom screening is not known. Means how often do you do it? We don't know. But at least in our setup in India, at least let's start doing something about it. We'll come to it how often one should do it. So is it easy to diagnose stress? You know, how do we recognize that the patient is stressed? Do we ask leading questions? Well, it's very difficult to basically ask leading questions, but I think it is time we start doing it, that no, we have to do. And I found a very useful well-being index, the WHO-5 well-being index. There are a lot of indexes on the net, infertility stress. There's a lot of infertility centers have different ways of screening for stress, and they make the patient fill up these forms before they come in. What I do is I found this very simple, just 5 questions over here. And it is by the WHO. And I have felt cheerful and good in spirits. I have felt calm and relaxed. I have felt active and vigorous. I woke up feeling fresh and refreshed. My daily life has been filled with things that impress me. So they have to mark one of these. All the time, most of the time, more than half the time, less than half the time, some of the time, or at no time at all. So if no time is zero, then some of the time is one. So obviously, if the score is lower, the patient is more stressed. So the raw score ranges from 0 to 25. Then the scores are transformed to 0 to 100 by multiplying by 4. With higher score means better well-being. So evidence suggests a score of 50 or below is inactive or indicative of low mood, though not necessary depression. And a score of 28 or below indicates likely depression and warrants further assessment. So these are the patients which you really have to take out from that whole bunch of patients which come to you and address their stress separately. And if the score is below 50, they definitely require some emotional support. So the other question which comes up is, when you talk about infertility, can stress affect fertility? So in a stress-induced, the recent research tells us that stress boosts the level of stress hormones such as adrenaline, catecholamines, corticosteroids, which can inhibit the release of GnRH. And subsequently, this may suppress ovulation in some women and reduce the sperm count in some men, because a high cortisol in a female will inhibit GnRH, reduce LH, reduce FSH, reduce estrogen, impair the follicular development, and affect oocyte quality. So all these things are attributed to a high cortisol. And a high cortisol in a male can inhibit GnRH, reduce LSH and FSH, reduce testosterone, affect spermatogenesis, and reduce the sperm count. So basically, we know that there is some association between stress and infertility. Many patients ask us, we are stressed, could that be causing the problem of our infertility? So research published in Fertility and Sterility, experts at the University of California at San Diego reported that stress may play a role in success of infertility treatment, including IVF. So they have done studies to prove that women with stress have ovulated less, had fewer eggs, and those who are more stressed were 20% less likely to achieve fertilization success. So stress and anxiety scores in first and repeat IVF, another study which says that stress and anxiety levels remain elevated across all cycles. Anyone on an IVF cycle is obviously stressed. Women with lower stress and anxiety levels on a trip prior to oocyte retrieval had a higher pregnancy rate. These results emphasize the need to investigate stress and reduce modalities and stress reduction modalities during the IVF cycle. So basically, all the studies, even large studies like the Swedish study of 23,000 women, says that yes, there is underlying stress which has to be recognized and addressed and treated. So managing stress is an important component of our treatment also. So what can we offer them? Now, in general, we say, "Are you ask them about stress?" They say, "Oh, I'm very stressed." No, relax, relax. But only saying relax doesn't help. In fact, they say it is counterproductive. You're telling relax has no effect on her. So don't try to just relax because you think that's going to help you to get pregnant. But just relax because it feels good, because it is comfortable, and because when you feel good, you are healthier overall, and conception and overall, and that can never be a bad thing for conception. If you realize today in COVID times also, what they say, it is very important to have a positive and always a good outlook. You can't get depressed in COVID times because that is counterproductive. Your immunity goes down. And it's a very clear, even today on Facebook, there was Dr. Shashank Joshi was talking about it with Dr. Harish Shetty. They said, no, you have to have a very positive and a strong outlook if you want your immune system to work well and prevent you against COVID. So it is important. Stress is important. And what are people trying to reduce stress in infertility patients? Acupuncture treatment is just prior and after embryo transfer. People have found a higher pregnancy rate after trying acupuncture. So no definite studies, but they say it could help. The numbers are very small, of course. Some people are trying massage, where they say that even foot massage before and after their thing, the embryo transfer, it's important because it reduces their stress. Some people are trying yoga and guided imaginary foot reflexology. They have this thing of foot reflexology. And they all say that in their centers where they are trying, Griffo and his center and all, that it helps people to relax and they have better outcomes. But what can we in India? We don't have a large building with an IVF center where we can have one room for yoga, one room for massage, one room for acupuncture. So what can we do in our consulting rooms? As a gynecologist, I think it's our duty to spend a little more time with these patients. If I get that patient who fills up this in the OPD, the WHO index, if I find that the index is low, give them extra 5 minutes during consultation to address the issue of stress. And I believe you women who are sitting over there, I mean, as a women gynecologist, you can probe much better into the stress aspect of women, and she will relate much better to you because many of these girls don't open up to us males. Someone lending a sympathetic ear to their problem also helps them to cope up. Simply listening to them also helps. Exercise, what can you tell them? That, listen, get out, do a little bit of exercise, do a little bit of musculoskeletal activity, and that releases endorphins in the brain, so that will help you to reduce the stress. It's a wonderful way of reducing stress. Distract with the hobby, take a break, yoga, meditation, all these things, even suggestions, if we give them, some of them may take up and they may be hugely benefited. And of course, tell them, don't take life so seriously. There is one book, this is the reason I put it up, there's one book available on the net also, on Kindle also, Laughing is Conceivable. Now, this is one book which a patient has written up after failed IVF attempts, and then how she got pregnant, and she's taken the funny side of the full treatment. So we as doctors will never come to know about it, but in this book which she has written, Laughing is Conceivable, it is nice to read. And I tell my patients, just, you're going for an IVF treatment, okay, read this book and then go for it. So at least they know that she's not the only woman undergoing all that stress, and there is a side to it, a funny side to it also. So we can give them simple mantras like control your thoughts. Now, we are no gurus or to give it, but the controlling your thoughts is also not easy. It's easy to say control your thoughts, but it is not easy. So can we give them some simple techniques? And one of the techniques which actually works is saying cancel. Like when there is a virus in the computer, you obviously delete. Similarly, whenever you have some, tell them if you have some bad thought or some negative thought coming in your brain and you know that this is counterproductive, it's not working. In our daily lives, we get so many negative thoughts. Arey, COVID to nahi ho jayega. Mask pehenna bhul gaye. Just cancel those thoughts because they are counterproductive. You have to loudly say cancel, cancel, cancel. Initially, in a day, you may say it 1,000 times or 10,000 times. But gradually, once you get in the habit of recognizing that this thought which comes needs to be canceled, then that will work, and you'll find yourself much calmer and much more better if you can control and do this. So you'll be more mindful rather than having mind full of thoughts. So that is one thing, you know, being mindful of everything, everyday things. Now, another small technique which I have is a 5-minute miracle, which I tell my patients to do. And this is simply something which you have to, I tell them, maybe with your husband, sit with your husband, 5 minutes opposite each other, close your eyes, hold your hands, and think only of the result which you want. So you want a baby. So just think as if the baby has already happened, the baby is playing with you, how it will happen, kaise hoga, kab hoga, kaun se doctor ke saath hoga, forget about it. Just think about the result. You are sending an intention to the force, and that will manifest. You are sending an image of the manifested infant. And that is a psychological behind the theory behind it. But it is just, it's a simple exercise. If nothing else, at least 5 minutes, they'll have some positive image in front of them and they'll feel better about it. So this 5-minute miracle I tell them to do. And there is something known as an attitude of gratitude. And I hope this video can play. Sorry. This is by Nitya Shanti, who had given me these techniques.
I'd like to talk about a very simple practice which we can do every morning when we wake up. I call it the lotus of gratitude. Now, as you know, a lotus grows out of the mud. The quality of the lotus is that that when the sun shines on it, it starts to slowly blossom, slowly open. And each time it opens, it reveals another inner layer of even more delicate, even more beautiful petals. Each layer is more beautiful than the next. So in this practice, you wake up in the morning, you sit in bed, and you put your 10 fingertips together, close to your heart. What you'll do is, you will start thinking of all that's beautiful, all that's really supporting you in your life. Could be people, could be situations, could be qualities, could be learnings, could be anything. And each time you think of something, you will open one of your fingers like a layer of petals. And you will inwardly say, I'm so thankful. And then think of something else. And inwardly say, I'm so thankful. And like this, petal after petal after petal. And go on to open all the 10 fingers. And as you open the 10th finger, bring both your hands on your heart. And feel truly blessed. Feel like the luckiest, most supported, most loved person in the world. Most fortunate being in the world. Like the favorite child of the universe. And feel truly like you're sitting right in the middle of a big, fragrant lotus. Your whole life is like a lotus field of gratitude. And that's a simple practice we can start our day with. You could even end our day with that practice. And in this way, what we focus on expands. If you start your day focusing on what's right, celebrating what's right in your life, you start finding throughout your day, you see more, you notice more, you enjoy more, you appreciate more the simple blessings that are already there. So try this simple practice of the lotus of gratitude. May you make every day a more grateful, more beautiful.
So that was Nitya Shanti, the person who has given me a little more techniques like this 5-minute miracle and other, the cancer therapy, which he's a sort of lifestyle guru. Very interesting, and he speaks very well. So that was for you, and I saw some of the doctors were really enjoying this. Thank you for that. Now, other mind exercises are, of course, hypnotherapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, and mindfulness, which, of course, is a more specialized technique. If you find your patient is a little more depressed, don't hesitate to refer them to somebody who can help them, whether it's a psychiatrist or a psychologist or something, and they will do something about it, you know, instead of just not doing it or anything, after recognizing stress, not doing it. Believe me, in our patients, most of the patients we'll be able to handle ourselves. But there will be patients. Some of them will be very depressed and who will require either hypnotherapy or even pharmacological treatment. So, you know, you have to look out for things like suicidal tendencies. You can't let somebody give up the life just because you're infertile or, you know, something like that. So you have anti-anxiety drugs, you have help available. Our job is to recognize this and then offer them the help which they require. If they are more depressed, if they are suicidal, I mean, sometimes I ask this question to my psychiatrist friend. He says, yeah, you don't have to hesitate. You have to be very direct and ask them, do you have suicidal tendencies? And if they reply yes, please don't wait. Just refer them to a psychiatrist for specialized training. So we must take it among ourselves. Of course, there are drugs like alpha-casopine, is like casein in milk, available as Oraspa also. Harmless drug, which I have used in some patients, and they found a little relief for a couple of months, 2-3 months there, they took it. So basically, when you talk about managing stress, talk to them about stress. The WHO-5 thing is available, or any other thing which you like, you can keep in your waiting room, or you know, tell them to fill it up before you and show it to you. Give them simple things to do. Open up their world a little bit. Tell them that a little bit of exercise helps, maybe yoga, maybe cancel, maybe the 5-minute miracle, lotus of gratitude. Any of these things we can impart on them by just talking to them for 5 or 10 minutes. So we can do that in 5 or 10 minutes as we are concerned. But if they are more stressed out, don't hesitate to refer for hypnotherapy or psychiatrist and think of drugs. So thank you very much for this. This is one small booklet which contains all these techniques. Mija, I have printed for the patients and I give it to them if I find that the score is below 50. Sometimes I give it to all patients, but mostly the ones whose score is below 50, I give it to them and I say that just go through it. It also describes a little bit about what IUI is, what infertility management is. So if you want, you can write to me at thanawalamaternity.com and I can email it to you anyway and you can use it the way you want. It's absolutely a done thing. So for any of you who would like to do it. So thank you very much for this. If anybody has any comments, I don't think there's any question, but if anybody has any comments, I would love to share. Anybody could just free to share with us. Yeah, Dr. Geeta, you are unmuted now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Khanewala.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Khanewala. It was a complete and informative information about PCOS and stress. Okay. Now I invite the questions. Maybe the end of the session, we will invite the questions.
Let me tell something about this lecture. Dr. Geeta, let me speak a few words regarding this.
Welcome, ma'am.
Dr. Khanewala, thank you. Whenever we are attending this webinar related to PCOS, we always read and in detail what are the causes of this PCOS, what is the pathophysiology, what is the clinical presentation, how does it produce stress, and how we can manage it by changing only the life pattern and the pharmacological and non-pharmacological method. You only elaborated beyond this pharmacological management of alleviating this stress. You have enumerated so many things which will help without losing a single penny and will improve the outcome of the management of the stress produced by the PCOS. Thank you, Thanawala.
Thank you so much. Sushma Chawla was quite enjoying the Lotus of Gratitude.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Proceed, Dr. Geeta.
Any role of antidepressant in the case of PCOD if the patient is feeling low, does it help? If the patient needs an antidepressant, even if she is a PCO or no PCO, please give it to her. So the antidepressant, whether she needs or no, maybe if you have evaluated and the WHO score is lower than 28, then please ask your psychiatrist friend to help you out and prescribe some mild anti-anxiety or antidepressant drug. You can't leave these people alone.
I think this antidepressant drug is more needed in that group of PCOS who are infertile and very much anxious, abused by their family members, their mother-in-laws, their husbands, and even it ends up to the second marriage of her husband. They need perhaps all these methods, including this antidepressant drug. Of course, other treatment or modalities of the pharmacological treatment is there. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now we have our another session. This is a panel discussion on update in GDM management. The panelists are Dr. Nirmala Singh, Dr. Sakshi Singh, and Dr. Meenakshi Kumari. The moderator is Dr. Thanewala only. Again, I request Dr. Maya Verma to please...
She can't introduce
me. She will be a chairperson. And I request ma'am to proceed, please. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
I welcome our panelists, Dr. Nirmala Singh, the CPTDM, Deputy CM of this big hospital of CCL at Ranchi. She is a very dynamic and young and the coming senior gynecologist. Still she is senior, is the most eminent gynecologist, a very pleasant personality. Always participating in all these panel discussion, presenting papers, and thus he will participate in very good manner and will elaborate as the update the whatever the updating in the management of the GTM, and so is the Dr. Sakshi. She is working in, she is very young, very dynamic, very, I can see you are very good spokesman and can participate in very well. She is practicing in infertility sector. And Dr. Meenakshi? Yes, she is also very eminent, young and dynamic gynecologist. I think both of us, all of them will enlighten us by their discussion regarding the management and updating of this gestational diabetes, which is very notorious in creating these all sorts of maternal and fetal morbidity and mortality. And they will enumerate related to the moderator questions. They will update the why and how they can be alleviate those complications of GDM, how they can earliest possible detect it, what are the protocol and whatsoever the related to GDM, which will make the outcome more beneficial to our reproductive age group of the for mother and the child. I welcome all the panelists. Please come and start, take your session.
I can see Dr. Sakshi Singh is the panelist, right? And Dr. Nirmala Singh, right? Yes, I can't see on my screen.
Meenakshi, just. Meenakshi. She was there right now.
I can't see her on my screen.
Itani, so. Just call her.
Tak, Meenakshi. I will call
her. The screen band karna tha, kya isliye nahi?
Yeah, yeah, she has come. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, she has come.
Okay, first let me get used to my panelists where they are. Yeah, Nirmala Singh is here. Sakshi Singh is here. Meenakshi Kumari, right?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. So it's great to have you here. And of course, the seniors, Dr. Barma is here and Dr. Geeta is also here. So we will just start with the panel again.
Hello, sir.
So let's come to some clinical situations in GDM. You know, it's just that it's simple. It's relating to clinical practice. What do we do when? Now, the first case, it's a 31-year-old Gravita 4, para 0, abortion 2, 1 ectopic. She came at 26 to 27 weeks with intractable vomiting one morning and upper abdominal pain, severe upper abdominal pain and tenderness. Her RS and CVS was normal. Her blood pressure was normal. She had a BMI just of 23. In spite of symptomatic therapy, pain in the upper abdomen did not decrease. You know, we gave her antacids and we gave her whatever we could think of, painkillers. And she became breathless. And then she had tachycardia. So Dr. Meenakshi, what will you think of in this? What condition? You have this pregnant woman, she's 7 months pregnant, fetal heartbeat is okay, uterus is relaxed, there's no problem obstetric-wise, but she has severe pain in the upper abdomen. You can think of many conditions. Some of the conditions which you can think of.
The severe pain may be due to a lot of condition, like she might have cholecystitis pain.
Cholecystitis,
gastritis.
So we had given her antacids, and of course in our small maternity homes we can't do much about this. And when she started having tachycardia and breathlessness, we transferred her to a medical facility with an ICU. And if it may just surprise you, her blood sugar came out to be 486 milligram per deciliter.
Yes, it's gestational diabetes.
So it's not only gestational diabetes, it's gestational diabetes, and she's gone into ketoacidosis. Now, ketoacidosis is a condition which happens when in type 1 diabetics who are sort of uncontrolled and, you know, they're not looked into, and then they go into this condition. in general, we looked up what went wrong in this case, you know. So before I come to this, the important thing of ketoacidosis is that when you have a ketoacidosis, you have to think, you have to correct the ketoacidosis first. You have to give this woman a lot of fluids. In the ICU setting, of course, and in your nursing home, you can start fluids and send her. But in the ICU setting, they have to give her insulin, bring down the sugar, control the ketoacidosis. And we as obstetricians are worried about what is going to happen to the fetus. Now, in this case, the fetus will have the fetal heart rate monitoring. You know, will have all the changes in the fetal heart rate monitoring. But in case your mother's condition improves and you stabilize her, many of these pregnancies will continue and the fetus will also continue. But we don't know what effect it has on the CNS. Now, unfortunately, this patient landed up with an IUFD, unfortunately. So the fetal mortality is very high. The perinatal mortality is very high. But of course, one has to think about such conditions because these are not, you know, in theory we read, gestational diabetes, one complication is diabetic ketoacidosis and other is renal pathology or, you know, things like that. But it can really happen if you don't take care. So when we did the ANC review, we found that in her ANC, one random sugar was done at 3 months of, she had come for booking at 3 months, which was 110 milligram per deciliter. Sugar was not repeated. Of course, she had undergone 3 sonographies. We are doing this in our practice. We are doing so many sonographies, but we are not probably screening for this medical disorders more seriously. So do you think, Dr. Nirmala, that do you think the screening was adequate in this case?
I know, sir. good evening, sir, and everyone. She might have subjected to other investigations also. As we do at 24 to 28 week size pregnancy.
What do you do for screening?
Yeah, OGTT. She might have gone for OGTT, sir.
So yeah. you would. What do you do in your practice?
With 75 gram of sugar, sir, we are doing it. We just take 2 readings, one fasting and one 2 hourly.
Excellent.
And yeah, and with that, so we are monitoring.
So when do you do this GCT? When do you do? At what gestational age?
Generally, so we do around 20 to 24 weeks. But book says 24 to 28, but in my practice, we are doing so within 20 to 24 weeks.
So, Dr. Sakshi, what do you think?
Sir, I would like to screen. We do universal screening for GTM since the Asians, the Indians, we are the high risk group. Especially if she gives a family history of diabetes. And am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, sir. For me, I prefer doing a universal screening for everyone. Which is, I screen with 75 gram OGTT in the first trimester, then again in between 24 to 28 weeks, and then again between 32 to 36 weeks. If she's had normal tests in the first 2 trimesters, then we'll test her again in the third one.
Here already she had undergone one test, random sugar.
So she's a diabetic.
And
if I'm not wrong,
no,
she's already a type 1 diabetic. She's a type 1 diabetic, so we should have done her...
is not diabetic.
Sir said that she is a type 1 diabetic, right?
No, I didn't say she was
diabetic. Anything of this sort.
We had no idea. Okay. Her BMI was low. We don't expect it.
Yeah, 23. She was just 23.
Not done a glucose challenge. So let me bring this out, that it is very important to do a glucose challenge test.
Yeah, OCTT should be done.
GDM. Now, you people are doing fasting and then getting 75 grams
of glucose. No. This is the regardless of her.
Only, sir, one reading, which is a WHO recommendation, after 75, 2 hours after 75 gram glucose, irrespective of the last meal taken.
Just dipsy.
Okay, so the DIPSI test is what even we have started doing now in practice. And I think Nirmala said that she is doing fasting and 75 GCT. So it is not wrong to do fasting and 75 GCT, but it's very difficult for a pregnant woman to come in a fasting state, especially in the first trimester. So now we have sort of given up the fasting thing because the results really don't matter. At the most, with the DIPSI test, your pickup will be a little more, but ultimately you can prove, okay, there was sugar is normal, then we are not worried about it. So basically what we are now screening is universal testing is what Sakshi brought about. And it's very important because we as Asians or we as Indians have a very high incidence of diabetes. So we have to screen all patients, young, old, whatever history, primary gravidas, because initially in the olden days, you say, oh, previous history of stillbirth, obese patient, history of diabetes. No, everybody needs to be screened. All women have to be screened. That is very, very clear now for the, even in the FIGO guidelines, we have to implement it now that universal screening, all pregnant patients will be screened because the incidence is 11 to 15%. And if you see the FIGO guidelines on testing, yes, they say OGTT or the IDGPS is what is the standard. But in the Indian subcontinent, you can do the 75 gram fasting or non-fasting, and we are now doing non-fasting, a 2 hour value, and give them 75 grams of glucose, make them wait, do a 2 hour reading of glucose, and if it is more than 140, label them as a GDM. There is no repeat test required. So, and this is to be done, as Sakshi very correctly said, all women in the booking in the first trimester, repeated 24 to 28 weeks, and also now they have started recommending 32 weeks. But at 32 weeks, whether to do or no is up to you, because in our country, not in all practices or in huge OPDs or general public, it may not be possible to do it. But at 32 weeks, if you pick up some sign like hyperamnios or a big baby or something like that, then again, please do repeat the sugars, because 16% of the women, according to the study by Dr. Sanjay Gupta in his Pune hospital, he said 16% of the patients develop who have got normal GCT at 24 to 26 weeks, 16% may go on to have abnormal sugar at 32 weeks. So that's about the screening. This is the protocol for investigation. Testing for GDM is recommended twice. This is the Government of India protocol which has been given. The first testing should be done during the first antenatal contact as early as possible in pregnancy. The second testing should be done at 24 to 28 weeks of pregnancy. There should be at least 4 week gap between the two tests. The test is to be conducted for all pregnant women, even if she comes late in pregnancy for ANC at the first time of contact. If she presents beyond 28 weeks of pregnancy, only one test needs to be done. So single step using 75 gram of glucose and measuring plasma glucose 2 hours after ingestion. It is to be given orally with approximately 300 ml of water, whether she comes in fasting or non-fasting state. And a standard glucometer also can be used. You need not always tell your patient to go to the laboratory. You can use a glucometer, especially in COVID times. We are relying so much on the glucometer now. If vomiting occurs within 30 minutes of glucose intakes, the test has to be repeated the next day. But if vomiting occurs after 30 minutes, the test continues as it is. And the threshold for plasma glucose level of more than 140 is taken as the cutoff for GTM. So, and this, now we have this anhydrous glucose available as a G75. So the advantages of this DIPSI test is it has got three times more pickup than with the other tests, two-step test, suitable for Indian settings, saves time, saves cost, avoids repeated visit, reduces repeated invasive sampling. So these are all the advantages. So we all must get one clear message that universal testing for all pregnant women, and definitely at least a DIPSI test, non-fasting 75 gram 2 hour eating. So that is what we must all now start doing. As I told you, these are not only complications which are on paper. They can occur, and you must remember diabetic ketoacidosis is precipitated by hyperemesis. So many of these girls who are undiagnosed type 1 diabetes, they may go into diabetic ketoacidosis even in the first trimester when they have hyperemesis. So please remember that. Okay, let's go to a simpler case. A 25-year-old PCOS patient who weighs 82 kgs with a BMI of 32.9. Her HB earlier when she was seeing you for PCO treatment was 6.1. Now she has come with a positive test. So can you prevent the development of hyperglycemia, and when will you order an GCT? Who will take this question? Is it Dr. Sakshi? Can you start?
So now the first thing that I would like to do over here is to test her HbA1c once again. If it has been, if the previous report is at least this gap of 3 months.
Before that, see, 6.1 is normal. Means it's not that she's a diabetic. She's just an overt sort of diabetic. So will you order a GCT in her?
Definitely, sir. At the first visit. Okay.
You will do it at the first visit. Okay. Yeah. So she had done a dipsy test and her test came as 175 milligram per deciliter.
And now what? HbA1c is also 8.5. So the first thing.
Order the HbA1c because let's remember that HbA1c is not routinely ordered. Of course, many people do it, but once you get a high glucose, especially in the first trimester, it's important to know what her glucose control was in the last 3 months. So you order a HbA1c of and it's 8.5. Now what do you do? How do you counsel the patient?
First of all, I'll need to counsel the patient regarding the complications that she should be prepared for and regarding the baby. Because this is the period of development in which she's being hyperglycemic. So for counseling regarding the prognosis, regarding the complications that she might face. And
What is it? Is it very high? What is the chance that she'll have a normal child or what is the chance she'll have a congenital anomaly?
So it's at least she's not an overt diabetic.
She is overt diabetic.
176.
171 8.5. This is overt diabetic now. Yeah, and this is in the first trimester. She is overt.
So we will tell her about the complications that the congenital anomalies that the child can have, and tell her that as the time comes, we can keep screening for the things. It is not necessary that the child will develop a cardiac anomaly or a CNS anomaly if the woman is a hyperglycemic or a diabetic. So regarding her own self, I would like to counsel her on the medications that she has to take. I think we should start.
We'll come to
instead
the
of going.
Let's finish off this thing. You have anything to add, Nirmala?
Yes, sir. As she is quite overweight, sir. For her, this we can say that this is morbid obesity for her. So, sir, she won't go for termination and all. She has to continue her pregnancy. So one by one, we have to tell her. Just what to do, what things to be done for mother and also for the baby.
But what about the congenital anomalies? Right now she's asking you that mera bachcha normal hoga ki nahi. Aur agar normal nahi hoga, mujhe nahi chahiye.
Aise to sir ki abnormal nahi hone ka nahi hai, but chances are there because we will then I will just do sir tests. As we are doing in first trimester.
So what is the percentage that of
there's a 5 times increased risk of congenital cardiac anomaly. There is also increased risk of caudal regression syndrome and other anomalies are there. We must do a anti-scan and we should rule out anomalies if there is a increase anti and alpha ketoprotein level etc are raised.
Sir, at this point of time we cannot assure her that the child will be normal or abnormal. We can just tell her the chances and tell her that
we will put her to the investigations first.
Sir, yeah. 8.5 with the HbA1c, if the HbA1c is more than 8.5, the chances of developing cardiac anomaly is anywhere between 3.5% to 25%.
Yeah, any other anomaly which she can develop?
So the neural tube defect, sir.
Neural tube defect, caudal regression syndrome.
CNS complications.
Yes. That is absolutely correct what Meenakshi said. You have caudal regression syndrome, CNS, cardiac anomalies we have to look out for. So there's a whole range of anomalies which can present when the blood sugar is high and the woman is conceived. But what are the chances this woman, before you send her for investigation, will ask you, ki bhi, main aage bhi badhun ki nahi badhun, you know? So you have to tell her that in general, what has been recorded in data is that if your HbA1c is still 6.5, there's hardly any increased risk. So that 1 to 2%, what is in general population, that is the risk. If it is less than it, there's a 5% risk of congenital anomalies. And if it is more than 10%, the HbA1c is more than 10, the risk goes up to 25%. So maximum risk which can have is 25 to 30%. So what we need to tell her, look, there is a higher risk. You are at 8.5, you have a 5 to 6% chance of having a congenital anomaly. But even if it is more, you know, there is a good chance, there is a 70-75% chance that the baby can be completely normal. And why do we tell you now that we have enough apparatus? We have got a good ultrasound machines which can pick up these defects. We have got biochemistry which can pick up some defects. So we will be able to pick up the defect, if not at 11 to 14 weeks, definitely in the cardiac scan at 18 weeks. So we can do that. And with that knowledge, she has to be put on treatment and she can carry on the pregnancy. So prognosis has to be explained, but termination should not be suggested or, you know, until she says, no, I just don't want to go. That is her wish. But in general, if she understands these problems, we can do a lot to find out if the baby is normal or abnormal. So basically, you're going to do that. You very correctly said 11 to 13 week scan. At that time, you also do a uterine artery Doppler to screen for the future PIH. And you do a double marker test. Now, when you are writing a double marker test, Sakshi, what any particular care which you have to take when you send this patient for a double? Are you people sending for double marker test?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So when you send a double marker test for a diabetic, what extra precaution do you have to take? In diabetics, what happens?
The risk of infection.
The maternal median PPA in type 2 diabetics and the beta HCG is sometimes lower than normal. So basically, in diabetics, your PAPA is lower. So you may get a false positive rate is higher. So when you are filling up that form for double marker, please make sure you mention. And they have a column over there. Most of the labs have a column over there. Mention that the patient is a diabetic, whether she's on insulin or she's not on insulin. Like all other columns, there is a column for diabetes also. So it needs to be mentioned that the woman is a diabetic when you send for a double marker test. So please be wary about that. Weight gain. How much weight gain do you think this woman should have in her labor, in her pregnancy?
I have to say it's not a recommended weight gain at stage. Already her BMI is very high.
Yeah, so yeah. BMI, all women who have a high BMI, please tell them right at the very beginning, you need not eat for two, whatever your family says. You are a diabetic. You need not put on 10 to 12 kgs. That is not normal for you. So basically 5 to 7 kgs is enough for you. That's what
5 kgs is enough. Yeah.
Okay, now the case 3, primary who was screened negative in the first trimester, now at 26 weeks, when screened again by 75 GCP, she comes with a reading of 188 milligram per deciliter. What sort of management will you give her? Now she is crossed the first trimester part. She was negative in the first trimester. Now she has come in the second trimester. So what is the... and now that the test which you have done, it is going to come as 188. What next?
Is manage on the case of GDF and first tell you have not mentioned what is her weight. We will give her advice regarding weight management, diet management.
Okay. So basically,
yeah,
you will advise her
medical nutrition therapy and physical exercise. And
so medical nutrition therapy, what do you advise?
We advise the depending upon what is her diet, she is advised to take carbohydrates. About 35 to 40% of her diet should comprise of complex carbohydrates, and the protein should be about 1 gram per kg body weight plus 23 gram, and fat should about 10% of the calorie should come from the fat. And there should be plenty of whole grains and vegetables and fruits, I advised. Total calorie should be decreased. And
okay, so patient ko aap, this is excellent. This is what a dietitian will normally do.
Yeah.
But Nirmala, if you can add on, how will you, in simple words, tell a patient that what's to be done?
Yes, sir.
And I think before we go on to that, one very important point. I think we have to counsel her about GDM.
Yes, sir.
We have to make her realize the importance of keeping her sugar under control. So, you know, the importance of maternal glucose. This 5 minutes, if you spend with her, believe me, she's going to follow your advice throughout pregnancy. You know, you have to tell her the importance of maternal glucose monitoring, the increased risk of having a baby who is large for gestational age, the problem which the baby can have if a sugar is not controlled, the long-term complications, that this baby will have diabetes because his pancreas program will be programmed and this baby will have diabetes. So that really gets to them and they follow all your advice. So spend 5 minutes telling them all this, you know, and then you say that you have to follow diet, exercise and keep your sugar control throughout the pregnancy well. So for diet...
Yes, sir. Everything narrated to her about diet.
Yeah.
And again, sir, I will give her, sir, 2 weeks time.
Yeah, with diet and exercise, you'll give her 2 weeks
time. Yeah, 2 weeks time. And again, I will call her and her blood will be tested for blood sugar, fasting, PP and HbA1c again. And by seeing that...
In the first trimester, you have anyway done it. She was normal. Now only 20 weeks, the sugar has come to 188. So HbA1c doesn't make too much.
Not very rolling in this case. Yeah.
So will you do her what? Blood sugar fasting and post lunch, or will you give her glucose again?
So here, so fasting and PP will do.
Yeah. So you can do fasting and PP. That should give you enough information whether the sugar has been controlled or not. And you have to make sure that the range, the fasting range should be not more than 90. And
yes, sir.
It should not be more than 120.
Yeah.
Sir, I would like to add a point over here.
Yeah, please.
Sir, regarding when I'm counseling her about the, we actually need to counsel her about the lifestyle changes that she has to bring in her everyday life.
Yeah.
Like regarding nutrition, we have to tell her that she has to divide her meal into 3 major and 3 minor. She has to design her, so 3 major meal, between each major meal, she has to take a snack time so that the average, she never suffers from hyperglycemia or a hyperglycemia. She can maintain an average blood sugar level. And we have to counsel her about the exercise that she can do. She can walk, she can go for a 30-minute walk every day. Otherwise, if she finds it difficult, she can just sit on a chair, swing her arms and legs for 15 minutes after each major meal.
Why can't she walk in the house after each major meal? Aapke rumar
one alternate method of exercising. We usually tell them to walk. No, sir, we tell them to walk for 30 minutes, but an alternate way to say this, if she feels lazy or whatever,
So that 10 minutes after a meal, if they walk, the sugar will be much better controlled anyway.
Yes,
so
yes, sensitivity will, sensitivity.
It's a very simple method, which, you know, we don't have, I have a dietitian in my setting, but everybody may not have a dietitian available to them. So what you have to tell them that in that thali which they take or the plate which they take, half the plate should be of vegetables and salads and fruits. So only raw stuff, the vegetable salads, too, cooked or raw stuff. Then 1/4 should be protein and only 1/4 should be starch. You know, that is how you have to explain to them. And so the full, you know, like even if you explain the hand to them, it is fine. And the proteins could be vegetarian or non-vegetarian. The start would be either rice or chapati, so, depending on what they want to eat. And a lot of vegetables, half the plate should be full of vegetables and raw food. And another good idea or a good point which some dietitians do is, you tell them, pehle tumhara ye portion khatam karo, fir pura protein khatam karo, then have the starch vegetable and protein. So by that time, they're less hungry. So that helps them to control the food. So this is simple things which we as gynecologists can do without referring to a dietitian. This is about the diet model which we can at least tell them, or before they go to a dietitian, we can at least tell them, itna to karo, and then you see your blood sugar. So anyway, you tell them about high glycemic food and low glycemic food, and exercise, like very nicely Sakshi has told. Monitoring, which method do you do over here? I think she's already said fasting and a blood sugar. But so one of the methods is doing a
self-monitoring fast. Second is self-monitoring by the patient.
Yeah, so that who goes in first? Nirmala, do you advise your patient self-monitoring?
Yes, sir. Depending upon the patients, all patients don't follow.
Follow, yeah.
If one can do, sir, nicely.
So basically two methods, and according to the government of India, a positive GDM, you can do medical nutrition therapy for 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, check 2 hour post glucose reading. If less than 120, continue the same thing and then repeat after 2 weeks. If more than 120, repeat every 3 days, and more frequent monitoring, or we have to start on drugs. Now, blood sugar monitoring, then the self-monitoring, what is the model? A little bit of practical tips on the self-monitoring is, and especially in this COVID time, it is very important to tell them that you give them that chart or that page which is available, printed page, which even the glucometer companies give you. Let's not have 7 readings, but at least initially for the first week, they can have those 6 readings, fasting, post-breakfast, before lunch, and so on. And then if all that remains normal, then you can ask her to take any 2 or 3 readings per day and, you know, email the reports to you or share it with you so that you can see how the sugar is. And I have found self-monitoring helps a lot, because the patient realizes, aaj maine ye khaya to mera sugar itna bad gaya, so automatically they try to control it better. So that's the advantage, I think, for self-monitoring of blood sugar. So it's up to you and on your practice on how you want to deal with patients who are on diet and exercise with the blood sugar. But once it is not controlled, then you probably will have to, you know,
put them
on drugs and definitely go for self-monitoring. Now, continuous glucose monitoring is coming up, but as yet it is very, very few patients needed who are on high doses of insulin. So let's not talk about that. So how good should be a sugar control, Meenakshi? How good should be the sugar control?
The aim of sugar control is to maintain the euglycemia status. The fasting blood sugar should be 90 to 95, and postprandial it should be after 2 hours, it should be below 120.
Fantastic. So that is what it is, and basically very well put by Dr. Sunil Gupta, who just did a Hello Diabetes conference in Nagpur. The in utero should not come to know that the mother has got diabetes. So I think that's a fantastic statement. If the baby doesn't come to know that the mother's got diabetes, means all control is good. So the baby should not come to know that the mother has got diabetes. The sugar control should be so good. And if it is controlled like that, then it is like a GDM, like any other normal pregnancy, which can just continue. Okay, now this patient comes to you, Sakshi, at 30 weeks, and she's developed hydroamnios. Now what do you do?
Sir, we will have to review the blood sugar levels first, whether she's been in the, like, what her sugar levels have been. If she has, the sugar levels are normal, then we'll have to see the development of the baby. Apart from hydroamnios.
The sugar levels will be normal if she has developed hydroamnios?
No, sir, there has to be something.
So there has to be an abnormal sugar, otherwise why should she develop hydroamnios? Yes.
So let's do one HbA1c if it has not been done.
Yeah, so maybe she's showing that the sugar levels are normal. Obviously, there's something wrong, so do an HbA1c. But then, if she's not on the self-monitoring, put her on self-monitoring first. Ask for an HbA1c and maybe start pharmacotherapy. Now, will you start metformin or will you start insulin?
So if only the blood sugar levels were deranged and we did not have any these signs like the hydroamnios or ultrasound, then I would have started with metformin. But here, since she's developing the complications of being a GDM, I would like to go on, if the patient is ready after counseling, if she's educated enough, she understands everything, I would directly go on insulin.
Yes, so excellent. That's the way it should be. She is already developed a complication of diabetes. She's getting hydroamnios. So maybe she is the one who requires insulin. If she refuses to take insulin or it's not practical, then yes, we may start metformin. And metformin is increasingly being used in our practice now. And we of course, metformin we've been using for PCOS for a very long time. It needs to continue for the first 3 months of pregnancy in those women. And even in GDM, we use it very rampantly. Now, if this woman has the slightest hesitation, hum log kitne bhi insulin mere ko prick nahi lagwana hai, fine, to hum log, we would have probably start metformin for 10-15 days. But technically, if Sakshi is right, we should put her on insulin, because we need a very good control now, because she started to develop complications, but metformin is a category B drug, but it does cross the placenta. So why the endocrinologists are so hesitant about metformin is that we have a follow-up till about 11 years of these children who have been put on metformin. And those children have done well till now, but they say that we really don't know because it crosses the placenta, we don't know. So we need to wait before we give it to all the patients. So endocrinologists are quite stuck with the insulin thing. But we as gynecologists and our patients, they would rather have an oral hypoglycemic rather than going on for insulin. So metformin has a huge role to play in GDM, I feel. And the Indian recommendations are that metformin can be given after 20 weeks of gestation. The dose is 500 milligrams BD and the maximum is 2 grams a day. And of course, it has some side effects and some women just don't tolerate it. So we have to be careful about that. But technically, approval for management and the management of is pending because from long trials haven't been done. Otherwise, basically a safe drug and can be used. So this, the treatment part here is changing a bit. Many people are definitely using an oral hypoglycemic before they go on for a insulin therapy. So, so this is how the government of India has given management of GDM with the patient, the medical nutritional therapy, like what all you have enumerated. I think I'm not going to go through it again. So we go through this part. What is your worry, Meenakshi, when she has hydroamnios, what is your worry? What are the problems which can occur?
As she is only 30 weeks pregnancy, this is a fetus is not mature enough, and there is a risk of maternal complication as well as a fetal complication if the hydroamnios and glucose level is not controlled.
Yeah. Very good. So what are the maternal complications you have? Or let's come to the fetal complications first.
Fetal complications, there's if see the hydroamnios is not controlled and fetus, there may be there's risk of prematurity.
Yeah. So when you think of
and respiratory distress syndrome.
Excellent. So to prevent that, what are you going to do?
We will give after controlling maternal blood glucose level, we will give steroids for fetal lung maturity.
What is the steroid which you use?
We usually use a dexamethasone.
Yeah. So what is the dose and what is the...
Generally, we give a dexamethasone in doses of 12 milligrams, 12 hours apart.
Yeah, 8 milligrams.
24 hours.
So if you're giving
dexamethasone, it is four doses of 6 milligrams, 6 hours apart.
Or you can give betamethasone, 2 doses, 12 milligrams.
2 doses, 12 milligrams, 12 hours.
24 milligrams dena hai over 24 hours.
Yeah.
And so now, if your patient is on is a diabetic, you have to be very careful because,
yes,
like you said, we have to give it under supervision.
If we have to admit the patient first. Yeah,
if she's on insulin, you have maybe some patients may require to be admitted
to monitor first,
the sugar.
Yes.
Otherwise, you may have a complication like diabetic ketoacidosis. This is another thing you can precipitate diabetic ketoacidosis. So patients on subcutaneous insulin increase all insulin dose by 50% 6 to 8 hours after the first dose of steroids and maintain this increase until 12 hours after the second dose of betamethasone or fourth dose of dexamethasone and revert back then to usual. So excellent. So steroids have to be given. Now this patient has gone into labor, Dr. Nirmala. What topolytics will you give her if she goes into a premature labor and you want to stop the labor? She starts getting mild uterine activity.
Yes, so in this case, so I would prefer to give her nifedipine and magnesium sulfate.
Okay, so magnesium sulfate is the preferred drug. Sorry, or nifedipine or indomethacin can be given, but
indomethacin.
A regular favorite betamethasone has to be avoided because that can again cause problems like hyperglycemia and put the patient into ketoacidosis. So this is important from the point of view of prematurity. Now let's come to a case where a primary with a BMI of 29, GDM picked up 26 weeks, Now she's on diet, exercise, and metformin. We have started her on these three things. And at 32 weeks, you get an ultrasound report saying that the baby is just 30 weeks. The abdominal circumference is just 29 weeks, and there's a lag of 3 weeks. Lyakar is also marginally less. The BP is normal. So you tell the woman that bachcha thoda chota hai. Or itna ug nahi raha hai. So she is very worried the baby is small. The mother-in-law is sitting on your head that tumne hi to sab sugar band karwa di, to bichari khayegi kya? So, Sakshi, what explanation will you give them?
No, sir, this is a sign of in a diabetic, if there is IUGR is developing, then that means there is potential insufficiency. So, the placenta is not working properly, and we need to do a Doppler study for the child, for the baby in utero, to see
whether... So what explanation do you give them why the baby is small? What is it a case of?
Vasculopathy, sir, in vasculopathy has developed in
So you have to tell her it's not because of the cutting down of the sugar. It is basically an inherent problem in the vasculature which has happened in the placenta, and that has got nothing to do with the sugar. If you don't control the sugar, it will anyway become worse. So what is the therapy? Do you ease out the sugar control?
No, sir.
You don't stop
better sugar control with insulin we have to use.
And do you give them all this, the IUGR cocktail? Proteins and
We will add them. But sir, the basic pathophysiology is with the vasculopathy, sir. So the strict control of blood sugar is the most important thing that has to be done here also. The only thing that we can do is to monitor the baby. The fetus has to be well in utero. It should not be compromised. If the baby is compromised, then we have to plan delivery.
So how do you monitor this fetus?
We will do keep doing the Doppler studies and the
non-stress test and CST contraction stress test.
No, once IUGR has been developed, we cannot depend on NST and stuff like that. We'll have to do a Doppler study. The duration of which will depend upon the findings that we get each time. If the ratios are normal, the middle cerebral artery and the umbilical artery, if the values are fine, like less than one and more than one, then we can keep repeating the Doppler studies every week. But once the cerebral thing becomes is more than one, then we need to plan delivery within 24 hours after giving steroids.
Whenever there's a cerebroplacental ratio goes below one, be very careful. This baby needs to be probably pulled out earlier. So be prepared for this. And there's an excellent answer which you people have given, that bi-weekly sonography and Doppler studies of the uterine and umbilical vessels should be used to follow up for a small for gestational age baby once it is picked up. The Doppler results indicate that the fetus is beginning to decompensate and delivery should be planned regardless of the fetal age. That's why that steroid is very important to be given. Now, please remember, in small for gestational age, Doppler is a good surveillance tool to judge and predict the turning point at which the decreased perfusion adapted fetus decompensate. But when the baby is large, or it's a sort of bigger baby or a macrosomic baby, and the placenta is usually large, there is always an increased blood flow and the wave curve is normal, such that the usual perfusion indexes fail to predict placental insufficiency. For a normal child or GDM or for a large for gestational age, Doppler is not going to help you. And even screening by AFI, you know, because in GDM, the AFI is always increased, like we saw in the previous case. You can't only rely on amniotic fluid. Of course, if the amniotic fluid is very less, it is significantly reduced. You must immediately deliver the child. But you can't predict either by AFI or any other the methods. So basically, even the recommendations, the FICO guidelines say that use of cardiotocography and biofilm profile or kick count as indicated according to local protocols. For normal GDMs, they really don't have any protocols on how to monitor the fetus. But once you pick up a small fetus, yes, a Doppler is going to help you for a small baby, but not for a large for gestational age baby. So that's what it comes with GDM. Now we have this, comorbidities are very common with GDM. So we have this 38-year-old conceived with IVF-ICSI. She also has a previous myomectomy done. In her medical history, she's a known hypertensive on labetalol and aspirin since conception, and the BP is under control. A 75 GCT at 26 weeks luckily came to be just 121. but a repeat GCT at 34 weeks, because the baby was appearing a little bigger on ultrasound, the sugar came to be 154 milligram per deciliter. So that is the importance of testing at 32 weeks. Now, will you add insulin and how will you manage the case? Patient was advised self-monitoring. She was put on diet, exercise for 7 days. Postprandial was always above 140. Metformin was started because she refused to take insulin. After the next 7 days, again, the PLPS was 158 and post-dinner was 165. So we advised her insulin. Are we correct in doing it?
Yes, sir. Now it's high time.
Yeah. So basically, if the blood sugar is more than, fasting is more than 120 or postprandial is more than 200, please advise insulin straight away. These are the patients who require insulin straight away. Blood glucose levels which are not met with diet, exercise and metformin, they should go for insulin. And if there are complications, as we have said, you know, hydramnios, etc., then they go for insulin. So which insulin, do you use insulin, Nirmala, in your practice?
Yes, sir.
So what do you start off with?
So we just use intermediate and short-acting insulins.
So do you send it to your physician or your...
So in my setup, sir, as I work in central government, so I have this facility and we send to them. Physician.
Okay.
And they just start.
Yeah.
Those they schedule according to the blood glucose.
Yeah. So basically you can use
intermediate and short acting, sir.
Intermediate and short acting. Sometimes basically many of these patients, JDM patients, have a normal fasting. So we may not even use the short acting. I mean, you may use only the short acting.
Short acting.
And it's easier for the patient to understand and us to monitor. I also normally send it to an endocrinologist, but when it's not possible to send it to an endocrinologist, at least the short-acting insulins which cover up each particular meal can be started by the gynecologist, because the dosage is very less. 4 to 6 units generally control the sugar. But if it's beyond that, yes, please take the help of a physician. We have to educate the patient on the sites of taking insulin, on how to take insulin, whether you do it, the physician does it. This all is very important. Now, patient was advised insulin. She was still adamant and we increased the metformin dose to 3 times a day. She did not take insulin. So this is how difficult patients can be. Post-dinner and fasting was still high at 36 weeks and she was started ultimately by our physician on Vesalog 4 units at 8 p.m. which controls the sugars effectively. The BP was under control with drugs. Urine albumin was 1+. We planned an elective section as 38 weeks, but the patient wanted to wait for 40 weeks. The estimated baby weight at 38 weeks was around 3.4. Doppler's and NST was normal. Will you wait, Meenakshi, in your practice? What will you tell this patient? Ki, theek hai, abhi rukte hai 40 hafte tak.
As the sugar is not controlled, the post-dinner and fasting are still now continue to be high.
Almost effectively controlled with Vesalog.
Now it is controlled. पहले नहीं था, इंसुलिन चालू किया, अभी कंट्रोल में है. सो उनको क्या बोलोगे?
There is a high risk of stillbirth in the late pregnancy. So we will try to make the pregnancy with patients
willingness.
Patient willingness. Yeah.
We should probably,
because it is already 38 weeks and weight is about 3.4 kg, and all the criteria, doctors, NHT is normal. The pregnancy should be terminated if the cervix is normal, and then induction of labor should be done.
Sir, I want to add one thing over here. It completely depends upon how intelligent my patient is. Though she is a hypertensive and her blood sugars are controlled, she is willing to participate willingly in monitoring the baby every time, every week. We can do NST and biophysical profile, ask her to count the kicks, and we can take each day as it comes. We can repeat the NST after every, or we can do NST on alternate days and a biophysical profile.
See, Meenakshi told me there's a high risk of sudden stillbirths.
Yes,
sir. We will counsel. And yes, sir.
This
we will counsel the
this
patient.
Happens, sir.
Now you are telling me, okay, I'm going to wait till 40 weeks because the patient wants it. So what?
No, sir, not 40 weeks. I'm saying we will take each day as it comes.
If it's already 38 weeks, then
Maybe it's generally we don't allow after 38 weeks in such type of cases, sir.
Yeah, in such types of cases. What investigations will help you in preventing a sudden stillbirth? Sakshi, tell me that.
Sir, I would like to go for a biophysical profile and NST and together with a daily fetal kick count from the patient. And of course, the blood sugar levels and the albumin levels.
Okay. Color Doppler is studied.
I would still, sir, yes, I would go by my patient. I would, if she's an intelligent enough to handle the situation, I will take each day at a time instead of doing cesarean at 38 weeks.
I would slightly warn you because there is nothing which will prevent a sudden stillbirth. You
know, yes, sir.
Going normal, next day patient comes with absent fetal hearts. And yeah,
but then she is
practically we are defeated so many times. So many times we have seen in practical life. Yeah.
There may be no changes in the Doppler because there is relative fetal hypoxia, which increases the risk of intrauterine death. Yes, because of GDM itself, there is a relative hypoxia. The other possible causes which are postulated in sudden stillbirth is vasculopathy, villus edema, maternal ketoacidosis in some cases, electrolyte discomfort, and fetal cardiomyopathy is another thing which is coming up. So you can't predict a stillbirth. Don't take chances. Yeah. Take that baby out and give it a nice baby.
How much intelligent your patient is, can't give this.
Yeah, yeah. Stillbirth is the worst thing.
All of a sudden this happens. All of a sudden.
I'll have to just charge my laptop. Please give me a minute.
Okay, sir.
So don't take any chances. See, 38 weeks is good enough to
For maturity of the fetus.
Maturity, you're not going to gain much. You're not going to gain much.
Yeah, after this, we might lose. No gain, but we might lose.
So
that's why I'm saying that I'll take one day at a time because 2 days of the stress and the patient
one day never comes, dear. Practically, so many times I've seen this.
Yeah.
And then you feel very bad for years and years together.
Dr. Verma here, or about interfering or waiting, like what Sakshi is saying.
Madam, boliye kuch.
So anyway, this is what UpToDate says, UpToDate 2018, and I want you to consider only these two or three points which I am highlighting, whether you agree with or not. One is they say that if the ultrasound fetal weight is less than 4.5, counsel and trial of labor and expectant in controlled diabetes, in uncomplicated pregnancy. Now, I think 4.5 by Indian standards, do you agree with it?
Yeah.
No, sir. This is quite very high, sir.
This is very high. So, I think we should take
3.5. It should be 3.5 in Indian context.
Even 4 kg is too much for Indian standards.
That's why I'm saying after 3.5 kgs, we should...
I think in what the Indian standards, 4 kgs and above is noted as lactoferrin.
Yeah.
Expected management until 41 weeks. Would you wait till 41 weeks in uncomplicated pregnancy of euglycemia or in with sugars controlled 41 weeks?
So
I don't think we would.
Practically never we do this.
So at the most, even if your patient is sugars are under control on diet and exercise, you would go maximum up till 40 weeks, right?
Yeah.
So not go post-atism. So let's remember that. Now over here also, I am not very convinced that after 32 weeks, NST with amniotic fluid index will help. Of course, they've written it because I don't know how Dopplers may be more effective than NST, but that is a personal choice whether you do NST at 32 weeks. I feel NST helps only after about 35 or 36 weeks, but that's of course a personal choice. Maybe after 34 weeks is okay. 32 weeks, I feel, is it too early. And another thing is counseling of a cesarean delivery at 39 weeks. Do you agree with that in a patients who are uncomplicated pregnancy, poor glucose control and who are on drugs? What does the government of India say? Timing of delivery, well controlled, decide for delivery after 39 weeks. If poorly controlled with risk factors, to be optimized by the obstetrician. So I think most people would probably better interfere at 38 weeks 38 and not let the pregnancy continue beyond 38 weeks. Correct?
Yes.
Now this patient, I think is the last situation, Geeta, 31-year-old patient, second gravida. She has delivered once before, a forceps delivery, 3.8 kg healthy baby. Now she's on mixed diet insulin in the morning and 10 units at night. Gross scan shown estimated fetal weight of 4.1. Sugars are under control. Will you induce this patient to prevent fetal dysphagia? Suppose I had said, instead of 4.1, if I say, suppose it is 3.9, and now she's 38 weeks, will you induce the patient to prevent shoulder distortion?
As the baby is more than 4 kg, there is a high risk of birth injury. But still, we will see that whether the pelvis is favorable and all the cervix is favorable.
Once she is gone.
Now, suppose she is 3.9. Do you think induction will help in preventing shoulder dystocia or let her go until normal labor?
That the cervix is favorable or not. If cervix is favorable, we may induce, but if it is not favorable, we will straight go for cesarean section.
Okay, no. And what are the problems do you anticipate of labor in a woman with GDA?
Shoulder dystocia is the first one, sir.
Also, brachial plexus.
About the last case, there is a study which shows that compared to non-diabetics, diabetics, if they are induced, you may prevent shoulder dystocia if the baby weight is more or less same. So, induction may have a role in diabetics who have delivered earlier, delivering, inducing them at 38 may have a role. That's all what it means. So, basically, in obstetric management, you have to be careful. So, a case of GDM, you are getting a fetal biometry corresponding to 38 weeks at 36 weeks and the baby weight is already 3.7. Sugar is poorly controlled till 32 weeks when insulin was started. Now, sugars are reasonably well controlled. So, basically, how accurate is the prediction of weight on ultrasound? Sakshi?
Sir, it is a very...
We can't hear you clearly.
It has... Now, am I clear?
Yes.
Yes, better.
So, it has an inter-observer variation. It is about, sir, from 12 to 16% of the fetal weight. We can get a variation of 12 to 16%.
Yeah, so it is never an accurate judgment. Never. So, you know, when you... I had a patient whose weight came on sonography to be 4.1. She had a previous normal delivery with 3.7, 3.8. Now, this was 4.1. I said, no. Let's not take a chance. You will have the same. She was a well-built, tall patient. She says, okay, we'll do a Caesar. And after doing a Caesar, the weight came out to be 3.6. So, you know, sometimes you get these things. So, be very careful when you tell the patient that, oh, on ultrasound, this is the weight. And believe me, whether it's ultrasound or your clinical judgment, it is very difficult to make out in diabetics what the exact weight will be. So, you have to remember this point while counseling your patients. And this was the induction study where they say that induction of labor reduces shoulder dystocia in patients who have diabetes as versus the non-diabetics. And of course, when in labor, you should always, your staff must know the drill for shoulder dystocia and you must take all precautions to prevent it. So let's just skip this. Suppose that LSS, you have a very big baby. Anybody, Nirmala probably would know this. How do you deliver the baby if the head is deep down and the baby is very big?
During cesarean, sir.
Big baby at cesarean, how do you normally deliver?
Just incision line, I make a bigger incision line, sir, because I have to take out the bigger baby.
You can do whatever then for the baby if the head is engaged.
Yeah, and while delivering the baby, we use the Patwardhan's technique.
So you can use Patwardhan's technique. Now I normally use forceps at delivery, so it is I use it for all my cesarean. Forceps.
Generally, sir, I'm not friendly with sir forceps during cesarean in normal delivery.
Yeah, but you know, it's a very easy thing to do. You just put the posterior blade, assemble the forceps in front of the patient, put the posterior blade, put the anterior blade around the head and just pull out the head. I'm telling you, it's a very easy and a very safe technique to do. You don't have that anesthetist giving pressure.
The bundle pressure.
Yeah, yeah.
So it is a very simple thing to do. I do it for all my cesareans. It is especially helpful in preterms where the head can just go up because it is
for floating heads. It's very
floating heads also.
And in some babies, but big babies, but worth it, especially when you take your incision and the shoulders are right over there and the baby is big. Take out the shoulders first. Take out the body, and then you'll be able to deliver the head easily. So that is a Patwardhan's maneuver. Third stage of labor, Meenakshi. Third stage of labor.
As the baby is bigger, we have third stage of labor should be managed, and the prostate gland should be used prophylactically to prevent the PPH. We must be very alert for there is chance, high chances of PPH is there.
So try and use a very good uterotonic, and uterotonic should be given within 1 minute of delivery and do a deep massage, etc. So watch for postpartum hemorrhage. Postnatal care. Postnatal patient has delivered now. What is the postnatal? One, you are worried about the baby for hypoglycemia, so you have to take care of that. Mother long-term.
And mother too.
So what is the message you will give her when she is going home?
Sir, first of all, about her food and how sir glucose just when to come for the test or it should be done. Yeah, sir. After a week, if she is going sir after cesarean, sir, generally we keep her for 1 week here and then send her home. That time also. We go for one blood test, fasting and PP, and according to that, so if she is on insulin or metformin, I discharge her, and weekly she should get her blood test for glucose. And second is, we do take care with antibiotics. We give antibiotics in this case for 7 to 10 days. Just to prevent any infection, as diabetics do very easily. About her bowel and bladder habits, I say I have to drink excess of water, no UTI should be there, or any sort of infection. And also, sir, for contraception, generally I call the patient after a month, and if she comes, sir, I give her for contraception.
Why don't you insert her IUCD before she goes home?
Generally, so we don't practice this.
PPIUD is an upcoming thing. You should keep it in mind. If the patient is willing, you can do a PPIUD.
Yes, sir.
Anything else? Sakshi, want to add something?
Sir, won't inserting an IUD in the postpartum period increase the chances of infection?
Infection, in this
case. No, it doesn't. No, there are lots of studies that you don't miss a chance, especially in a practice where your patient may not come back to you in the general large government.
So they think it to be a foreign body and they don't want to put inside their body. That's generally
to know that you have to educate them that how it will help.
That we do a lot, sir.
You have to educate them and convince them for a postpartum IUCD, but whether you do it now or after a month or so, but you have to give them a very serious advice about contraception. Tell them that you are a GDM now, your sugar may become normal.
Normal, or
the testing is generally at 6 weeks, at 6 months, and once every year. She needs to go OGPT at that time and report to you. So basically, on every child's birthday, she should send you a OGTT ka
before taking cake.
The GDMs will turn into diabetics within 5 to 7 years. 50% of them turn into diabetics. So you have to, pull it in their heads that you have a higher risk of becoming a diabetic. So continue that lifestyle change which you have done now. Continue your regular exercise and diet so you will not become a diabetic. So those ones who are only GDM or metformin or diet, maybe they will not even progress to become a diabetic. But keep a watch on them and tell them that this lifestyle thing continues. A very serious talk about contraception, because tell them if you become a diabetic and you conceive, again there will be a problem. So all these points have to be brought out to them before you discharge them. And of course, a very important point which you have to say, Meenakshi, you want to add something else?
We have to also tell the patient that there is a risk of future obesity in the baby. So the baby should be also well monitored in the when it will grow, it has a high risk of developing diabetes and cardiovascular disease, etc. So it should also give proper weight management of baby is also essential. And
so you stress on the fact that she has to breastfeed the baby for 7
years. Yeah, early breastfeeding should be started and this should be continued till 6 months. Exclusive breastfeeding should be done.
Also. So that is the postpartum care. So many points which even FICO says that we must be very careful in telling all this, you know, early detection of infection, support of breastfeeding, advice on pregnancy spacing, and retest all women at 6 to 12 weeks postpartum, and future blood sugar tests should be done. So all, unless we catch this group, which we have picked up to be a GDM, we have sounded them, ki tumko problem hai aur aage jaake ho sakta hai, you know, unless we do that, the incidence of diabetes in our country will not go down. If we take it upon ourselves and do this, maybe a huge impact will happen, not only in this woman who will may not progress to become a diabetic, but on the fetus, if the blood sugars are very well controlled, that fetus in future life will not become a diabetic. So you have in the next generation, which is going to have a less incidence of diabetes than we have. So that is the importance of GDM. Believe me, we obstetricians are in the limelight or in the spotlight now. It is all upon our shoulders to pick up a GDM properly, to make sure the sugars are controlled properly so that the fetus doesn't get any bad effects of a high sugar in utero. And so the fetus, that whole generation, is prevented from all this NCDs which we are talking about. And of course, this woman, it's like a stress test for the woman. You know, if she's got a GDM now, she may get diabetes in future. So she has to keep it in mind and continue all the prevention measures which we have stated. So that is, I think, covers up quite a bit of the stuff of GDM. Anything else any of my panelists want to add? Nirmala, Meenakshi, or Sakshi, or even Dr. Maya, anybody who wants to add anything, most welcome. Any comments?
Nicely covered everything, sir.
Everything has been covered.
Left. Yeah.
All aspects of thing has been
GDM
covered.
GDM,
So I think I'll stop sharing my screen. This is the Foxy Focus, which I had bought out when I was Vice President of Foxy.
Basically
on NCDs, yeah. You know, how to prevent NCDs in the next generation.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah,
one thing I have to say, that perhaps we have missed one point. If you have selected a patient for induction of labor and the patient is on insulin, how to monitor that at that time, you have allowed the patient to go into labor. It is not contraindicated to have a labor, spontaneous labor. If she is in euglycemic state and throughout pregnancy, she has controlled her blood sugar, every finding is within normal. And you suppose this lady may have normal vaginal delivery. So the management of that vaginal delivery, how to prepare the patient, how to monitor the intrapartum period, and what to do after parturition. So this point perhaps is
it was getting a little bit long, so that's why I thought maybe we should, this is something which known, but any of the panelists who would like to say, suppose you are inducing a patient or even if you are taking him for cesarean and if the patient is on insulin, I think Sakshi can elaborate a little bit. If the patient is on insulin, how do you go about monitoring the sugar and during the labor?
When you are preparing for cesarean section, when you are doing cesarean section and just after finishing the cesarean section, how to monitor or regulate that insulin in infusion?
See, we let her have her whatever little snack or she wants. We start giving her ice chips and stuff. But as far as the blood sugar monitoring is concerned, there are two ways of dealing with it. We give insulin either following the sliding scale, or we charge 5 units of insulin in a 5% dextrose solution and give the patient.
So these are the practical things. When we are doing cesarean section, you have selected, you are doing cesarean section, you are thinking about the insulin, what to do when a patient has brought to the labor operation theater, whether you will give insulin in fasting stage, how much you will do, give insulin in the 5%
the first morning, the morning dose of insulin
that has to be omitted. She is in fasting state.
I will just clarify during cesarean, if she's in the fasting state, no morning dose of insulin has to be given. Only the last dose of insulin which she takes is in the previous night. In the morning, generally schedule your sections the first thing in the morning, because the woman is going to be fasting. You obviously have a glucometer doing the sugar, and depending on what the sugar is, you would start. In generally, we start a drip of ringer lactate initially and do the sugars. And generally, they don't require any insulin until after the surgery and all. And we keep doing the sugars every 4 hours by the glucometer and titrate the insulin dose according to that. Now, if a patient is in labor, or even if she comes in as a indirect labor without induction, you're going to do her sugars. And then depending on that, we need to monitor the dose of insulin. Okay, now the only thing is, with the last dose of
insulin, things has to be kept in mind while we are dealing with this diabetic patient during labor and parturition, whether normal or whether a cesarean section.
Yeah, in generally, you should maintain the sugar level within the normal. You can't let it
go. So they are very much liable to go into hypoglycemia also. Yeah, and is in very low level, the ketoacidosis.
Yeah, yeah.
So we have to manage it, keep eye on it.
IV fluid going on, ma'am. Oh, I'm not giving IV fluid.
We obviously have an IV line going on, and depending on what the
sugar level is,
like glucometer, we add the insulin. So that, I think, and this is glucometer, I think everybody.
And one more point. We have to take care of that newborn child also. They may develop
hypoglycemia.
Identified immediately, they may go further in further deterioration of the condition.
After a few hours. So basically, you do the sugar at birth and you do it repeated after about 2 to 3 hours anyway, and see how the baby is doing. Some of the babies in our own nursing home, we can start a drip, and generally they do pretty well.
Yes.
But we encourage early breastfeeding.
Neonatologists, they take care of early care of the baby.
Encourage, and generally they do very well. There is one more point which I had actually put in a slide earlier, but we didn't discuss it, is a PCO woman who comes to you and
yes, already on metformin.
Prevent her from becoming a GDM. Something which we are using in PCO and which we can sort of continue or even start in pregnancy to prevent a GDM.
Minus two. So if a patient is already taking minoxidil or metformin, we generally continue that for at least 3 months.
And even if she's not taking, there is now evidence coming up that minoxidil during pregnancy also may help the woman.
To prevent her from other problems, we still have studies to come,
but smaller studies have shown it definitely has a role of improvement. So that is from the point of view of preventing, including the exercise, the diet, and amongst the drugs, yes, inositols are coming up as the drugs.
So for how many months we should give?
No, you can give it
throughout pregnancy.
You can give it throughout pregnancy.
Yes, and aspirin should be added, sir, in that condition.
Yeah, yeah. Aspirin one can.
CS patients, we generally saw. I'm just thinking of preeclamptic toxemia and all, or IUGA.
This aspirin can be included when there is past history or there is very high risk patient for the developing preeclampsia.
PCOS patients generally, and these days patients are elderly, obesity.
After NT scan, we can see the resistance in
14 to 16 weeks of pregnancy, generally we start.
Routinely.
If the resistance is high, ma'am, then you're doing the NT scan, we see the bilateral uterine artery resistance.
At that time, RIPI.
It has a predictive value. It has a value in predicting preeclampsia, development of preeclampsia in that
case. Yes, just to prevent preeclampsia. When you think about preeclampsia, then you will add
aspirin.
Because, ma'am, Cochrane has proved that ecosprin doesn't improve the pregnancy outcome. It doesn't alter the outcome.
So 150 milligrams of aspirin at bedtime is started in all the women who have a high risk of preeclampsia.
Yes.
So we have one question here. How should be the plan of management of a type 1 diabetic patient with 2 or 3 first trimester recurrent pregnancy loss already on insulin with the HbA1c ranging from 6 to 7? If the HbA1c is 6.7, her diabetes part is controlled. You have to look at the other parts of recurrent pregnancy.
Yes, sir.
She has got anything else. She has got any
other investigations.
Antiphospholipids are normal or no. Uterine cavity is normal or no. So you have to look at those aspects also. But the sugar part should be quite controlled with this. Then,
About contraception, sir, we did not say more. Which contraception should be given in
apart from the RTPI, IUCD.
You can use any contraceptive. Unless she is a cross diabetic, maybe you will not use OC pills.
Generally, OC pills we
don't give. You can use
just progesterone pills we give.
But the progesterone pills have high failure rate. Yeah. They have a high failure rate.
Progesterone or barrier method. Generally, after six weeks of low dose OTP, Mirena advocated,
keeping in mind on blood sugar control, the low dose OCP is also given today. It is not completely contraindicated.
There's no contraindication.
You have to monitor blood sugar only and counsel the patient also.
Liver functions and other factors also.
Yes. So the home tech message is when you detect the GDM earliest possible in the during if possible, screening well, counseling the patient, detecting the GDM depending on its level, let's say there's change in lifestyle, change in food habit, exercise, not responding. Again, monitoring, go to oral hypoglycemic, controlled, no control, again, screening, follow-up, then shift to insulin, parenteral anti-diabetic drug, and must not forget to take the help of diabetologist. Must take care of that medico-legal aspect. The counseling, and then monitoring properly, documenting everything, and then at every step the counseling, and no loophole in our management. I think so.
Sure.
And also the care of the baby, saying about this future development, the possibility of their future development of becoming diabetic. Everything we have to keep in your mind, it's not a joke to manage a case of GDM.
Yes.
We almost forgot the role of an ophthalmologist in case of her.
Complications and severe degree of
talking about GDM, so I didn't bring it up.
Sometimes it becomes so difficult to counsel and to make the patient to avail this your medical treatment. I have one bad experience. Then one lady, a wife of an advocate, and long ago when I was in medical college, that lady had diabetes, gestational diabetes. She delivered one baby, cesarean section. Next time, obese lady having diabetes. Next pregnancy, multiple pregnancy, not ready to take any anti-diabetic drug. Always insisting for Ayurvedic drug and having regular antenatal checkup. And in those days, this ultrasonography was not so frequently done. And that lady one day, in spite of my all insistence, in spite of all my counseling, she refused to take any drug except that Ayurvedic drug. And one fine morning she came that she has lost fetal movement. I could not help her. For my counseling, she could not blame me. For my insistence for taking medicine, she could not blame me. And so her husband was advocate. He could have fined me like anything.
Ready
to deliver those twin babies vaginally at RMCH. And so I still remember that patient, that single patient who refused to take any medical advice.
So she might be an educated lady.
Yes.
Wife of an advocate.
One of these educated ladies under GDM to come to me for, I used to send them for sonographies, obviously, outside, and basically send to a diabetologist for insulin control. So they stopped coming to me because ultimately what happened.
Yes, so this is one of the more problems.
They changed the doctor, sir.
So their work is done. But no, I think obstetrics has a huge role to play.
Yeah.
So it happens 30 years ago. And still I remember her face. And my face too.
So I think we're okay to close. It's already 7.
Yes, sir.
We are very much in time. Indeed. 5 minutes left.
Yeah. So basically, this glucose screening is important from the 75 gram packet, and the S75 also. It's easily available now. Initially, you know what Dr. Sheshai and Walt used to do. He used to have glucon D ka packet lo, 100 gram packet. So now all the problems have gone, and we've got this S75 available.
75.
Easily, so and now I keep a stock in my hospital. Patient comes for a in COVID times, if they come with an analysis, and I give them the packet ke 26 weeks pe ye peeke 2 ghante ka sugar karke mail karo. Because we have to change our practice with the COVID times. We have to
treat
them less frequently.
That means, theoretically, it sounds very well. And we have to follow the guideline. But sometimes it becomes very, I myself feel very confused. Again, a lady, 20 weeks pregnant, no history, family history, no bad, any suggestive history. But then asking her during her first pregnancy, first visit, in first trimester, so 8 weeks pregnancy, diagnosed 6 weeks pregnancy, I will tell her to take 50 grams, 75 grams of glucose and then get blood sugar done. Sometimes that patient may be not very convenient to take that, and that time is the random blood sugar level, still it is going on.
No,
and then it gives to that 75 gram.
I think it's better to do a challenge test because sometimes we miss.
Yes.
In some women, most women do it. That mental block is more with the obstetrician at first time.
Yeah.
But in generally, most of the women do.
Some patient vomits, sir. They vomit it.
It's not very easy.
We tell them to take it very slowly. But they vomit.
75 gram glucose to ingest at a time. It's not so very easy.
Slowly. We say that sit down and just sip by sip like tea. You take like tea.
We can add lime, sir. We can add a dash of lime.
Yeah. Just a few drops.
Yes,
please. Just advise them to add just few drops, not more.
All these are grassroots problems.
300 ml water with 75 gram glucose. It is little difficult to ingest.
Yeah.
300 ml. Usually we say 300. It is written also. Guideline
it's
is
written, but in a glass, total glass space they can have. And that they have to take very slowly.
So we will start monitoring timing will start after the glass will finish
last sip. After last sip she
last
has to
sip.
See
last
yeah.
sip of the last glucose sip.
Yeah
sip the glucose.
2 hours she has after to last start sip.
Counting the time after 2 hours of the last sip of glucose. Is it?
Yes.
She has to take the glass of glucose over half an hour. Within half an hour, she has
to slowly sip for one hour so that she won't vomit it out.
According to the guidelines by the Government of India, she should finish it within at least 10 minutes of ingestion. You can't take half an hour to ingest it because then the
10 minutes is enough.
Half an hour, you have to repeat the test the next day.
Yeah.
But if you don't vomit after half an hour, it doesn't.
If she vomits out within half an hour.
And it's just half a glass of water, so it should not be very difficult for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
10 minute time is also a long period. It's not very short period.
Ma'am, tea time for 10 minutes we get, no? So that time she has to take.
So I think Balaji, can we end now, or Geeta?
Yes, very well, very nice done, Dr. Dhanawala.
Thank you very much.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Yes. It finishes now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you to all of you.
I thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Professor Dhanawala, Professor Maya Verma, Nirmala, Sachi, Minakshi, all audience, yeah. And the last, Sachi, not the least.
Nirmala done very well. Answered very
well. Yeah. But sir, I still disagree on the 38-week thing.
You are in infertility management no more. So when you will do this general practice of obstetrician, you will see my goodness.
See, you have to motivate the patient for that.
Yeah.
But always
see, nowadays 39 weeks for the normal patient. We induce
unpredictable outcome do occur.
All of a sudden.
Recently, last hour the stillbirths are increased.
So you cannot be very sure that everything will go until unless it has gone well.
No. I'm telling Sakshi is, yeah, if your patient is insisting that she wants to wait till 39 weeks, take it in writing from her.
Medical legal, you have to go for this.
You can do
never anything. Forget that medical legal aspect.
Yes.
But I'm telling you, you will lose your sleep every day.
Every day, so every minute.
Now we are in hand of that more.
We're talking of a complicated case. We're talking of patient who's on insulin. We're not talking of a patient who's only on diet and exercise, you know, who can fall till 30 days.
You see, in day-to-day,
and you are not monitoring her at her home, because one of my patients, who is, happens to be my sister, is a staff nurse in the hospital. So she did blunders. She had so bad obstetrical history, and is it also when she lost her child 8 months completed, and she had one stillbirth baby, male child. Then after that, sir, she had infertility for so many years, and she ran from here to there. Then she came to me. I just did everything, every investigations. And that time she was quite okay. Investigation wise, nothing was there. Even they did not report about her anatomical defect and anything. So coincidentally, she just conceived with my treatment. When I got her APLA syndrome done, she was APLA positive. Later on GDM, followed by just overt diabetes very soon. So. Very soon, just in second trimester, I think. These developments were just after pregnancy. Before pregnancy, so her glucose profile was quite okay. Her HbA1c was quite within normal limit. And no family history, nothing. So anyhow, so I kept her in low molecular weight heparin and this, that, and also insulin. I kept her almost admitted after second trimester. She used to say that because she was very much worried. Always she used to say, "Kemko fetal moment nahi ho raha, ye nahi ho raha, wo nahi ho raha, ma'am, gas banda hai." So I kept her just in the hospital only, and with planning. So in 37 weeks, when I delivered her by cesarean, I saw she was having just a unicornuate uterus. And cesarean was also very difficult. I did. She delivered a female child. Everything was quite okay. When the baby became of 2.5 years, she again started saying me, ki, ma'am, hum try karein 2-3 mahine se. Mera ye nahi ho raha, ma'am, humko ek bacha aur chahiye. Please do something for me. Again, so I started and I gave some ovulatory drug and she conceived on her own. From very beginning, she was already, she had discontinued her medicine without my suggestion. Medicine of metformin, what she was going on with metformin, she had left. Again, so when I saw everything, I started her on insulin. and she conceived. Everything was going quite fine, sir. In 34, after 34 weeks of her pregnancy, I gave her betamethasone, kept her in hospital, and everything was going quite well. She was very much confident by this time because she was having one baby and she was thinking this time also I'll be quite okay. 35 weeks of pregnancy, almost going, almost completing. She one day she just told, ma'am, sir, she came from home, sir, just beside the hospital her quarter is. She came from there in the evening and told her fellow sister, I'm not feeling movement. She saw with Doppler, fetal movement was there. Ultrasonography done by the sonologist of our hospital. She reported me everything is fine. That day I was at home. It was late evening. I told her to give her sugar was checked. It was a little bit, perhaps around 100. 100 or 110, like this. But still, sir, I kept her on RL and oxygen given. And then I told her, don't go home. Please be here because tumko feel nahi ho raha tha, so you be here. After sir finishing her RL drip, and just I think it was just 1 hour or 1.5 hour of doing that ultrasonography. When she was going, her fellow sister, she saw her fetal sound with the Doppler. No fetal sound was seen. No fetal sounds.
Yeah, it is sudden stillbirths are known. That is what we brought it up.
So what can... I get mom.
It is sometimes we have a
shock. Yeah, I had to rush. I had to recheck everything. This, that, again, cesarean for dead fetus. this time she conceived with treatment also. No, on her own, third caesar. And not very good baby, though every test was quite okay. But her doctor's study was not so well. Sonologist told me, ma'am, you have to just give her 1 week, maximum 1 week. I mean, that time her pregnancy was only 30 weeks. Only 30 weeks pregnancy. So I just referred her outside. In my this capacity, I can't manage you. You go outside. I referred her. But later on, something happened. She had to go to our RIMS hospital. And there she delivered in 33 weeks of pregnancy. With consistent monitoring, there's her NST, there's that, color Doppler, every alternate day. Anyhow, we could take her pregnancy 2 weeks more. And 33 weeks.
Many of these patients required extra care, and we all have these high-risk patients, which we have.
Yes, sir. High-risk and sleepless nights, sir. We can't eat, we can't. Sleep, we can't do anything nicely.
Thank you very much for sharing all that. Thank you, Dr. Verma, for being here, and thank you for inviting you to Ranchi.
Thank you, sir. So nice welcome. Of you, sir. Ab hum log chale?
Bahut acha hua aaj.
Acha hua na, madam. Pradam, madam. Haan, bahut badhiya se hua.
Last time to is baar bahut acha hua.
Haan, nahi, wo thoda connectivity ka problem tha, wo apne haath mein le liye thi, hai na, usme gadbad ho raha tha sab. Chiki, usme presentation tha na. Usme presentation tha, isme to presentation ek hi aadmi ka tha, isme koi dikkat nahi thi. Usme alag alag aadmi ka presentation tha, that was the reason.
Abhi 4 August ko,
जी.
अभी 4 अगस्त को एक और है, अभी गीता बताएगी. मेडिको लीगल पर है. हाँ,
ठीक है मैम. ठीक है मैम जी,
ठीक है. अभी डिटेल गीता बताएगी सब. आज अच्छा हुआ, अब सेटिस्फाई नहीं तो पिछली बार लज्जा से मर गए.
हम भी मैम, हम हमको बहुत बुरा लगा था.
शुरू ही इतना बेकार हुआ था, बिगनिंग ही एकदम अच्छा नहीं हुआ था.
कोई नहीं मैम, कोई नहीं मैम. इस बार दूसरे फार्मा कंपनी वाले हैं मैम, इसलिए वो जान जाएंगे पहले वाले के बारे में, इसलिए हम लोग एक बार में बात करेंगे.
एकदम जब हसाई करा दिया था पहले.
प्रणाम मैम. प्रणाम मैम.
प्रणाम प्रणाम प्रणाम.
ओके, बाय जी.
थैंक यू मैम. मीनाक्षी, थैंक यू दी. थैंक यू,
बहुत अच्छा किए. मीनाक्षी, साक्षी, सबको बहुत अच्छा किए.
प्रणाम मैम.
ठीक.